everyone, welcome to the Dr. Music Podcast once again, where I have the honor of sitting with songwriter, guitarist Marc Ferrari. Most of you probably know Marc as a lead guitarist for the band Keel. Over the course of his career, Marc has donned many hats. He is an entrepreneur, an author, a producer, a car collector, and mountain climber. We'll ask about that. One of his short-lived but exciting band projects was Cold Sweat at the beginning of the 90s. It got a little bit rolled over by the grunge scene, of course, like every other great rock band. Marc and the rest of Cold Sweat have given the band a pulse once again. Brand new record called Unburied Alive, which happens to be on Ron Keel's RFK Media label with a bunch of other great bands. Marc, it's a pleasure to have you, man. A real honor. Thank you.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm looking forward to spending some time with you today.
Yeah, I appreciate it, man. I appreciate it. Man, I say all that, and, Keel was big in my life when it came out. I was in high school and really impressionable, young, musical mind. That band, so much talent in it. To see you guys doing... still making music, still being productive, is real pleasure for me, man. You guys are heroes to me when I was a young kid. So when you look back, how do you feel about that music, most of it, and we're talking about Cold Sweat too, when you look at your debut, how's that feel to you when you listen to it?
Well, I'm proud of the work that we did, and I think, in the case of both bands, you had guys that were in it for the right reasons. We were all of us in both bands, all passionate about music, which is one reason why all of us decided to take that path in life,
Yeah.
And I can tell you that with both bands, we didn't succumb to outside influences. We wrote and recorded the music that was true to our heart. We weren't influenced by any outside forces. Although, Keel did have a couple of, on the last Keel album, we did have a couple of songs that were written by outside writers, but those were songs that we chose to do. Mm-hmm. Somebody's Waiting, was actually one of our videos, on the last Keel album.
Right.
But, I'm proud of the work that both bands, did. And, here we are, 40 years, actually. 1984 was when Keel formed. Here we are in 2024. So it's the 40-year anniversary of Keel forming.
Awesome.
Last month was the 40-year anniversary of the first Keel show. And we'll be rolling up next January to the 40th anniversary of the release of The Right to Rock, So, I'm super stoked that, both Keel and Cold Sweat were remembered fondly by everyone.
Yep.
And both bands are still somewhat active.
It's amazing, man. It's so cool. It's great to see Keel. Ron's a friend and just a great guy. Done the interview with Brian Jay and all of you guys are still active. You're still great players. You're still just the chops are there. To have that possibility of music together is really fun for the fan like myself that such a big impact in my music the way I listen to music really early on. So Cold Sweat, you put out that debut. It does well, but the grunge scene's coming in. It just wasn't the right timing. You put out this. You get the band back together. Same thing. All you guys active in the music community. All you guys got your chops. You're still playing. And Roy's just killing it still.
Yeah.
Just an amazing voice. You do the M3 festival. How's that feel? That's the first time, was the band, was it as tight as you would have liked? Was the crowd as you would have liked, all of that?
Just to correct you, it was actually our third big thing that Cold Sweat played. The first one was 2020 on the Monsters of Rock cruise.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then 2 summers ago, we did the Monsters on the Mountain Festival in Tennessee. And then, as you mentioned, last weekend, we performed at M3 and we crushed it. You can go online and see all the chat rooms and everything. We crushed it. And we don't rehearse all that much, you know. In this case, you know, we hadn't played in 2 years and we get together in a hotel room and just bang things out acoustically. And we knocked it out, you know, and that's a testament to all the guys in the band, you know, the level of musicianship and our passion for what we do and wanting to always give the best performance regardless of how much rehearsals we have, you know. Somebody joked, you know, if we had more rehearsals, we might have sucked. I don't know. We just, you know, we all know what we have to do and we all bring it on, you know, on game day, you know.
It's just great, man. And, you know, I've had Chris on and, you know, he's a brilliant mind. He's just so sharp. And, you know, I mean, he is the guy where, you know, we've had long conversations and it's like, you know, whatever he says, he's so focused in everything he says and everything he kind of thinks that way. So, you know, it's one of those guys I can just imagine musically, he's just spot on, you know, or he wouldn't be doing it. You know, so that's really cool to hear that it went so well for you guys too. More appearances or music from the band, you know, was that talked about?
Well, we're already announced on the 2025 Monsters and Rock cruise.
Yeah.
So that's already on the books. And, you know, we always submit ourselves for other festivals and stuff. We hope that there's some more work out there for us this summer. But, you know, we compete against many, many other bands. You know, on any given festival, there's only X amount of slots available.
Sure.
And that's just... that's just the nature of the beast. You know, you've got 5 slots or 10 slots available at a festival and you get 50 bands that all want to be there. So we have some of that working against us, but we are submitting ourselves for other things on the Cold Sweat side. Cool. And on the Keel side, we're hoping also, you know, next year with the 40th anniversary of the Right to Rock that we can honor that milestone the best that we can.
Yeah. Oh, that sounds great, man. That sounds great. The live recording that we hear on Unburied Alive sounds really sharp too. It's really great. That's Germany in 19.
Well, there's two. Right? Okay. So
the one at the end, right? Mannheim.
That's the one at the end is from Mannheim, Germany. And it's a little rough, you know, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
I believe it was recorded off a cassette, you know? And so there's only so much, you know, audio magic you can work on those recordings, you know. And the other recording on that album is from the 2020 Monsters of Rock cruise that I just mentioned earlier. So yeah, so Unburied Alive is very appropriately titled. The Unburied part refers to the 4 demos that were recorded back in 1990, late 90, early 91. And those have been buried for all these years. I don't even think they were out there on the internet. So that refers to the Unburied part, those 4 recordings, and the Alive part, Unburied Alive, are the 2 separate live recordings that we just talked about.
Right. Now that 2020 recording is fantastic. It's just a great recording. The Germany one, that's more for the hardcore fan, I think, is, you know, that's one of those things. When I'm a big collector, obviously. And, you know, I pick up everything I can from a band, you know, their demos, the things they sent, you know, on their answering machines, you know what I mean? That's the stuff that is really enticing to the hardcore fan. So, you know, the hardcore fan's going to love that cassette, rough, you know, really muffled kind of recording of that Germany show from 1990. It's kind of one of those little nuggets that, you know, is a little bit special. But that 2020 recording is sharp. It really sounds great. The 4 songs, is that all that was there? You know, I think about that vault and a big safe and I open it up. There's those 4 songs that have been sitting there. That is super exciting. Did you take 4 out of 10 that were sitting there? Is that everything out of the vault, those 4 songs?
You know, there might be a few other golden nuggets still in there. That's all I'll say on it.
That's cool to hear, man. That is really cool to hear. Are you guys talking about making new music, writing new music for Cold Sweat?
Yeah, I think you'll see a single or two dropping. You know, I don't know if a full album is in the works.
Okay.
And the same on the Keel side too. Even though, you know, we kind of do have standing offers from a couple of labels, but it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work, and you know, unfortunately, the financial rewards on releasing up albums these days just aren't what they used to be. Not that that should be the only reason why, you
Well,
know, any recording artist should re record music, but you're finding the same even from the big bands. Aerosmith, you know, Kiss, they haven't done anything in a while. Aerosmith, you know, it's just the nature of the business right now. But singles are easier to do, and you know,
it's kind of a singles world too,
yeah, I think you'll see something from Cold Sweat later this year.
That's cool. That's great, and that is really cool. You've written Rockstar 101, kind of a how to, succeed and be successful in the business. That was 2002. You got, of course, this classic, Don't Dilly Dally, Silly Sally. Thrilled to have that. Just a really cool thing you did. Children's book for your daughter, right? Ever consider an autobiography? Your story from beginning to end, from
Well,
beginning to current.
there's some of that in Rockstar 101.
Right.
You know, Rockstar 101 really at its heart is a reference book. You know, it's a how-to book.
Right.
But there are some, you know, I did populate it a little bit with, you know, some stories of how I started and, you know, my career path. So I think some of that was addressed there. And, you know, I'm not convinced that my life story is that anybody would, you know, I don't know. I've done some interesting things, but I don't know if it warrants a separate book.
Okay. Yeah, and when you say interesting things, like I mentioned, car collector, mountain climber, what is that, 17,000 feet or something to the Everest. Wow, 13 days on the mountain. Tell me a little bit about that. Is that that's just a passion, right?
Well, yeah, I've been an avid outdoor guy for most of my life and love camping and hiking, and I've been backpacking with a bunch of guys here for the better part of 25 years. We go up to the sea for a weekend or something, or in the wintertime we go out into the desert and we'll go to Joshua Tree or Death Valley or Anza Borrego. But one of my bucket list things was to go to the Everest region, you know, to go to Nepal and see the Himalayas. And I finally got that done with a couple of buddies of mine. We just decided, you know, let's just do it. Let's quit talking about it and let's just do it. So we went, it was actually close to 3 weeks overall, or 2.5 anyways. But the actual part of trekking, it's actually not mountain climbing. I want to make that
Okay,
clear. I didn't,
more
it,
hiking,
it,
right?
it's called trekking,
Okay.
but you are, you know, hiking at high elevation. You know, and not everybody acclimatizes to that well. And that was, yeah, it was better part of I think 13 days or so on the trail up and back to Everest Base Camp. So
In the
you're
clouds at
walking.
that point.
Yeah, it was about 40 some odd miles from where we started to where we finished. But it's a lot of up and down and up and down and up and down. But that certainly was one of the big adventures of my life. Just getting to Nepal and getting to the town that you start your trek at is a bit of adventure,
Yeah.
because you're flying into one of the world's 10 most dangerous airports to get
Oh,
started.
really? Oh, man. Wow. Wow.
On
Yeah.
this little puddle jumper that doesn't have any radar and can't turn around once they get into that valley, and you know, it's pretty nuts.
That is, see, that's what I'm saying, man. Your adventures, and they continue. You had MasterSource on a business side, on an investment side. a real adventure for you. Grunge comes in, cold sweat kind of, fizzles from that a little bit, which ultimately gave birth to MasterSource for you. Tell me about that time in your life. Was it, it's, I mean, it was a great financial gain for you, I think, right? But, your music got put to the side a little bit. Was that disheartening for you, or was that
Well,
a fun adventure for you?
it was the performing part of things that got, I decided, it was going to be pretty tough for me to try to get another record deal in that environment back in the early 90s when the grunge guys were having their day. And, I wasn't about to change my stripes. I'm a dyed-in-the-wool commercial hard rock guy, 70s based. And that was just not the conducive era, for guys like me to try to get signed again. And I started getting some of my demo recordings used in TV shows and films. I had friends of mine that were working in the industry and, were looking for music from background scenes and stuff. And it just gave me an idea, wait a minute, there's something here. Just made some money licensing this song, and I just made some money licensing that song. And, I happened to hit on this idea at a very opportune time because there weren't a lot of sources back then for filmmakers and TV folks to go to for music that sounded similar to the artists of the day. I wasn't ripping these guys off, but I was creating, these guys were trying to license a Led Zeppelin song. They were never going to license it. It's going to cost them a couple $1 million and take them a year. So I said, forget about that. Forget about trying to license that Zeppelin song or that AC/DC song or, whatever it was at the time. I'll create something for you that sounds in the ballpark of these guys. And you know what? You can take off a decimal point or two of the license fee. You can have it next week or whatever. So,
And Marc Ferrari can do Zeppelin-esque, that's for sure.
that was the genesis of what became MasterSource, which was the business I formed and I ran for better part of 15 years before selling to Universal in 2007. And then I stayed on 5 years after I sold the business to them to keep running it, And to this day, even though I'm not a Universal employee anymore, I'm still creating new music for that library, and I have other clients that I produce music for. And it keeps me busy, it keeps me engaged, it keeps me close to music. And I don't have to go on the road anymore,
Which is not easy. Yeah, that's
And
awesome.
it's something that I enjoy. When I do my job right, everybody wins. The
And
client
then,
wins, songwriter wins, I win, the movie wins, everybody wins.
yeah, and that's the key. You gotta feel good about it. You gotta enjoy doing it, and you do, and that's good to hear, man. That's good to hear. You produce this record, part of it, right?
Well, I didn't produce the whole album, but I produced the song that Pantera covered on that album.
Okay, just the one song.
Yes, just the one song. Yeah. And even then, I'll go on record saying, I kind of co-produced it because, Vinny really was the kind of the guiding force there and the dad on the recording studio. And, he was very helpful too. The dad just passed away. But yeah, they like that song, Proud to Be Loud, which originally was intended for the last Keel album. And I don't even know why he didn't make the album. I can't recall, but Pantera loved it. And I flew down and, quote unquote, produced the session and just kind of guided Phil as to vocal lines and stuff. I did play rhythm guitar on that song. And I also played a lead on another song on that album called We'll Meet Again. So
Cool.
that's a hard album to find. I don't know if that's still in print or not, but
It,
they probably
yeah, I, it was an import from Italy, and I had to snatch it up. It
And
was
there's
cool.
actually a there's a YouTube video of me jamming that song with them. You can find that.
Man, that is just awesome. And I have to ask you, when you know that material and you knew them early on, when you heard the Cowboys from Hell record, which was right after that, what was your first thought? hearing
Well,
them do that, because it's so different.
it's kind of like a caterpillar morphing into a butterfly.
There
You
you
know,
go.
they go into the cocoon and they come out a different creature.
Yep.
And that's what happened with Pantera. By the way, they got progressively heavier after I Am the Night was the third album, which was the last one they did with Terry Glaze. That got a little heavier. And then the one that you just showed, Power Metal, got even heavier. It shifted from, the first two albums were kind of like Def Leppard meets Motley Crue meets Dokken, but they progressively got heavier. Then it was more Judas Priest and Maiden. And by the time they got to Cowboys from Hell, they had made that transformation, you know. And they follow, you know, look, they followed their passion. They stayed true to who they were, you know.
And that's
And
important in the business, isn't it?
I think people smell a rat, you know, when a tries to be something they aren't, or they try to try to shift to trends, you know. People, and we know there's been several bands that have done that, you know. But people, they sense through it. Pantera was the real deal, you know.
And that's pretty obvious. They do what they do really well. And still somewhat out there. At least Phil and Rex there, but so that's kind of cool to see. Car guy. If you had to choose only one, which one is it? The Aston Martin? I know you love that car. I know that.
Well, I started, I actually got into, high-end sports cars a little later in life. I didn't buy my first one till I was 47, maybe. I bought the
Oh, okay.
Aston,
Wow.
and because some guys, they're dyed-in-the-wool car guys from grade school. But I had friends that had, Ferraris and Aston Martin and Porsches and stuff, and they were like, "Come on, man, join the club," you
Well, you
know.
have to, right? Your name
Yeah,
is Ferrari. Come
yeah.
on.
So yeah, started out with an Aston Martin Vanquish, which was that car, the 2002 model, which was in the Bond movie with Halle Berry. I forgot which one it was, but it made its debut in that movie. And then I had that car for about 3 years, and I rolled into a Ferrari. I rolled into a 430 Scuderia, which is a tr you know track. A track car variant to the 430, and I had that one for 6 years or so, and now I have a 458 Italia, which is
Cool.
for all you car geeks out there, it's the last of the naturally aspirated V8s. All the V8s now are turboed in Ferraris, and a lot of the purist guys are not happy about that.
It on the track?
I have not tracked this car, but I've gotten it up to speed a bunch of times.
That's
I
crazy.
drive it aggressively when it's safer to do so.
Pretty awesome, pretty awesome. All of these things we talk about. There's so much. Your music has touched so many lives. You do all these passions of yours. You take part, and the fun financial gain of like the movie session stuff. You're just taking care of you, your family. And that just a great story you have. It really is. Anything left on your bucket list? You wanted to do the Nepal thing, and you've done that. You got the car thing going. Your music is still out there. All of this great stuff happening for you. What's left? Is there something else that you just say, God, I haven't done that yet?
Well, when you climb a mountain, you see more mountains. So, look, there's some travel I'd like to do. Certain parts of the world I haven't been to. Always wanted to go to Australia, New Zealand. I want to get that done.
Cold sweater or Keel, maybe.
Certainly, I would love to go back to Nepal. That's such a or. The Himalaya region. There's a couple of other countries there I'd like to visit: Tibet, Bhutan. So there's some travel I'd like to do. I think I still have some creative juice left in the tank here. I'd like to I'd like to see some more recordings from both Keel and Cole Sweat. And just I want to live in a happy, healthy life. That's the most important thing.
That's so awesome. Yeah, so you can do Keel or Cold Sweat music, tour to Australia or, and climb a mountain while you're there. How cool is that? Kill them all right away, I'm looking forward to it, man. Mark, this has been an honor. Thank you so much. Looking forward to everything you got coming up. We will keep in tune and get the word out. And we appreciate you, man. Thank you.
All right. Thanks so much for having me.
All right.